If you had not turned away, I would certainly have killed you by now, but I would have spared it. Balaam said to the angel of the Lord, I have sinned. I did not realize you were standing in the road to oppose me. Now, if you are displeased, I will go back. The angel of the Lord said to Balaam, go with the men, but speak only what I tell you. So Balaam went with Balak's officials. God gave guidance through angels to people including Hagar in Genesis 16:1-12. If you remember, who's Hagar? The Egyptian slave girl to mother Sarah. In Genesis 16:1-12, Sarah, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children, but she had an Egyptian slave named Hagar. So she said to her husband Abraham, the Lord has kept me from having children. Go, sleep with my slave. Perhaps I can build a family through her. Which is the normal thing that we normally do as human beings when we run out of faith. And who can blame Sarah? She was already 70 years of age. But Abraham agreed. Like all men, because we are all men, we will agree, of course, to what Sarah said. So Abraham, after I've been living in Canaan 10 years, so Sarah, his wife took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. He slept with Hagar and she conceived. When she knew she was pregnant, that is when Hagar knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. You could see now. They say one wife is a challenge. Two wives, a boxing ring. Three wives. You had the Biafra war on your part. And four wives, you better save for your funeral. For your funeral. Amen. 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 I know what I thought, I will have to hope you are free. Amen. So when she knew she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Then Sarah said to Abraham, you are responsible for the wrong I am suffering. I put my slave in your hands, and now that she knows she is pregnant, she despises me. May the Lord judge between you and me. Can you believe it? Abraham didn't ask for it. And now she said, may the Lord judge between me and you, as if to say she was the one asking Sarah to despise him or her. And of course, you can't catch a man by the elbow. You wring it out. So he said, your slave is in your hand. Abraham said, do with her whatever you think best. Then Sarah started to mistreat Hagar. So Hagar fled from her. The angel of the Lord found Hagar near a spring in the desert. It was a spring that is beside the road to shore. And he said, Hagar, slave of Sarah, where have you come from? And where are you going? She said, I'm running away from my mistress Sarah. She answered. Then the angel of the Lord told her, go back to your mistress and submit to her. The angel added, I will increase your descendants so much that they may be too numerous to count. The angel of the Lord also said to her, you are now pregnant and you will give birth to a son. You shall name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard of your misery. He will be a wild donkey of a man. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand against him. And he will live in hostility towards all his brothers. You may be wondering, who is Ishmael? Who is Isaac? For the benefit of the little time we have today, this is the cause of the problem we have in the world today. Through Isaac, We have the generations of Christians, the generations of the 12 tribes of Israel, and through Islam, we have the 7 kings of the Arabic countries that form the Islamic states today. And you could see the rivalry that started from the mistake committed by our mother Sarah. All the descendants of Ishmael, the radical Muslims, are against the Jews. And that rivalry still continues today. So it is not a political problem. It is not American problem, but a problem that was grounded right from the beginning. But if you are reading your Bible, you not even listen to the politician because you know the source of any problem. And only God can solve it. Only God can solve it. The mistake has already been made. And nothing can solve it for us. So this is a fine example of divine or spiritual guidance, which most of us must have experienced at that critical hour of our need, especially those who survived life as refugees in war and crisis-torn nations all over the world, where there are nowhere to turn. How many of us have experienced or had stories of rejection from those in whom you have built all your hopes? Maybe your husband, maybe your wife, that we so call our soulmate when the going was good, only to be woken up in the middle of the night and the one having the upper hand telling you, darling, he still call you darling, in the morning pack all your belongings together with your child and leave my house. I used to wonder. When I hear men threatening to divorce their spouse or sell the house or even divide or drive the spouse with whom the two of you have struggled together to build a home, God saw the affliction of the helpless Egyptian housemaid of Sarah, Hagar, being driven from her home where she was already a second wife. But when there's no one for you, God is always there and will not desert you. But we guide you on what to do. And the angel of the Lord said unto her, return to thy mistress and submit thyself under her hands. Hagar obeyed the guiding instruction of the angel of God. And through her seed, God's promise was fulfilled in her life. How many of us have had that personal encounter from God or his messengers? As he turned his stubborn hearts to spiritual guidance. Many of us are suffering today from different types of infirmities in our life. And Jesus Christ has been waiting for us to guide us, but we still continue to refuse his hand of friendship. I had my own experience of spiritual guidance, which is a testimony I'm sharing today with you. I had my own experience of spiritual guidance when my second time I came to Maryland from California, and the room I was supposed to occupy was unexpectedly occupied by a young nursing mother then desperately in need. My pastor then gave me an option, either to stay with her or to share with some fellow Christian families who were also ready to come and pack my things the following day. That night, I slept. Before I was warned in a vision that the woman I ran away from, who masterminded my first exile back to California, will come back to rape me. In the morning when I told my reverend the vision, she acclaimed, this is terrible. You are not going anywhere. You stay here with me under my protection. And had been staying with her for the past 6 years. We are no Jezebel could come and get me to go provide my accommodation. When I am now wise enough to always put on my chastity belt. Praise God. Amen. Thank you, Reverend. You are laughing. Amen. In the New Testament, we have many instances where God guided his anointing. In Luke 1:19 to 20, Angel Gabriel was sent to a great Jewish priest, Zechariah, where he was ministering unto the Lord to announce the great news of the coming of the Avenger through his family. Despite the fact that he and his wife were advancing age, Zechariah, of course, like most of us, disbelieved. And Angel Gabriel was not furious with him, but gave him guidance in form of advice in order to prepare his mind for the holy servant of God that his wife will be carrying for the next 9 months. As we read in verse 19 to 20, and the angel answered said unto him, I am Gabriel, that stand in the presence of God, and am sent to speak unto thee, and to show thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb, and not able to speak unto the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season. When the angel Gabriel appeared to her mother, Mary, and announced the great tidings of the Immaculate Conception of our Lord Jesus Christ, the man to whom she had been betrothed became suspicious and uncomfortable, since he did not have any intimate relationship with Mary. But because he loved her very much, he planned to terminate the relationship quietly, so as not to embarrass her, the woman of his heart. The Lord saw his problem and how to guide him, as we also read in Matthew 1:20-25. But while he thought of these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with a child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means, interpreted, is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and he took unto him his wife, and knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. God is always with his son and his earthly parents. And when Herod Antipas sought to kill baby Jesus, his devilish plot was not hidden from God, and he gave Joseph spiritual guidance to guarantee the safety of Jesus, as we have also read in Matthew 2:13-14. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, Arise, and take the young child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night and departed into Egypt. The Bible told us that the three wise men were warned not to go back to Herod, and the result was the ruthless murder of thousands of innocent babies in Judea, which fulfilled the prophecy of the identification of the Messiah. After the resurrection of Jesus, Peter became the head of the flock. And when he came to the house of Simon the Tanner, God showed him a vision where he saw a vessel in which were all kinds of beasts. And the Lord said, Peter, arise and kill and eat. But because Peter was a devout Jew and strict disciple of Christ, he resented the call and replied that he had never touched or eaten anything unclean. But the voice persisted, and admonish him, saying, what God hath made clean, thou must not call unclean. And the vision appeared three times. And what happened to justify this spiritual guidance? And let us also see Acts of Apostles 10:17. And now while Peter doubted in himself what this vision which he had seen should remain, behold, the men which were sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate and called and asked whether Simon, which was surnamed Peter, were lodged there. While Peter thought on the vision, the Spirit said unto him, behold, three men seek thee. Arise therefore, and get thee down, and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Who was Cornelius? He was a believer, but a Gentile that was also hungry for spiritual food and thirsty for the good news. And there was no one to satisfy his thirst for Christ